Surgery. Kenley will be having surgery. That's Latasha's baby. And also Sandra Wise is not doing good at all. Brother Chris needs prayer for his mom. She needs a miracle. Amen. If you have a need, lift your hand this morning. We're going to go to the Lord in behalf of all our needs today. Brother Dale, lead us to the Lord.
Bless Jesus. Hold our hand this morning. We thank you for being in this service. We praise you, Lord God. We thank you for your mighty God. And you died on the cross for our salvation, for our healing, Lord. We give you all the praise and the glory, Lord, this morning. Father, for each one who's come with a need this morning, for sickness and body, Lord, for financial blessings or whatever the need may be, Lord, we know that you're here, willing and able and ready to meet that need according to your riches and glory, according to your authority here on earth. Lord, bless us as we go throughout this service. As we hear your word, we pray that you bless the teachings of the word. Father, we thank you for this church and for our singers and musicians. Bless our pastors as they guide us, Father. Bless our country. Bless our nation. Lord, bless the city and community, Father. We give you all the praise and glory.
Amen. Also, on our prayer request, we also need to remember Wesley Allen. Wesley's a young man who was raised here in our area and just a dynamic young man. Used to travel with us on all the church trips and stuff. Somebody open that door, if you would, please. Amen. That's my grandchild. She's crying, she's got to go. But Wesley is in real, real critical state with brain cancer. And you see posts and all your friends sending words of encouragement and keep praying for him that God will give a miracle. Fine young man that's helped a lot of young people through life. And let's remember him when we pray as well. This morning, ushers, if you'll come to receive our tithe and offering, go forth in Jesus' name as we bring to the storehouse this morning. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. everybody can just realize that he's more than enough. We tend to search to fill the voids in our life. And if everyone could just get in their hearts and their minds that Christ is enough, because we serve a great and powerful Lord. Do you believe that this morning?
Is broken.
And just to embarrass him because I get that privilege, I'm going to tell my son, happy birthday. He is 16 this morning.
Thank you.
sing this morning. His Robbie can get it together this morning. Are you glad we serve a faithful God? We've been talking so much about the grace and mercy of God, and I'm so thankful that we serve a God that decided to show us grace, amen? In the midst of our sin, through all of our doubts, through all of our mistakes, we serve a God that loves us regardless, unconditionally, amen? Thank God we have a way back to our Savior when we mess up, right? Thank Him this morning, and we know that Matt is going to bless you this morning. He's having to get tuned up. Of course, his roadie didn't have things ready, but he failed this morning. Angela found out this morning that Matt was singing, and she looked at Melanie and she said, "Oh, thanks. You made me sing when Matt sings." But I love to hear her sing. Amen. And I love those old songs. There's nothing that blesses me more. Let's worship with Brother Matt this morning.
It's worth the wait.
Don't Most people's prayer life consists of this, Sister Barbara.
Thank you, Lord, for what I'm about to receive to eat. Amen.
Oh, yes.
Three times a day. And that's the extent of talking to a heavenly Savior. And one that has saved us and loved us, he ought to be the first one you talk to in the morning.
Amen.
And the last one you talk to at night.
Amen.
And throughout the day, you need to talk to him.
Right.
And let him know that you're there and you're listening and you love him and you're concerned about his will in your life. But let's talk about Satan's plot for a little while this morning. Now, the devil is going to use four avenues in order to try to carry out his plot. Number one will be distraction. Number two is distortion. Number three is he's going to use some decoys. And fourth is trying to get you to destruction. Now let's talk about his distraction. Satan is always trying to distract you from some things. Number one, from the body of Christ. To lead you out of church and get you out there as a sheep by yourself, that he can devour you quickly and easily. He's going to try to take you away from the truth and the word of Almighty God, because he realizes that the truth is what sets you free. So he's going to try to take you from the word of God to get you to argue and to listen to somebody else that's going to give you what is not correct. He wants to take you from all spiritual weaponry, because he does not want you equipped with the armor of God. He's going to try to take you from healthy relationships and people that have same interests as you do. That they love to talk about God, and they love to talk about church, and they like to talk about gospel songs and things like this that build and edify one another. He wants to rob you and take you away from that. But he wants you to be distracted from who God thinks you really are. You've got to get in your mind that you're wonderfully and fearfully made after the image of Almighty God. That you are somebody in the kingdom of God. You're a son or a daughter of the Most High God. And the devil does not want you to understand that. Some people give the devil credit for everything that goes wrong in life. And we blame the devil for everything. The devil made me do it. No, pure meanness made you do it. Stubborn will made you do it. Just being mean makes you do some things. And then you throw it all on the devil. Amen? I love you. He always comes as a wolf. And if you always see a wolf coming, you know to guard against that. But the devil does not show up the same way every time. He shows up different ways. And let me tell you, he'll even use people in the congregation sitting beside you. Don't stare and call people names. But he'll use people inside of this body to distract you. How? Well, it's people like this, the critical people. It's too hot. It's too cold. Too loud. Too soft. Too short. Too long. And they're critical about everything. Isn't it a beautiful day? What's so beautiful about it? Don't you just want to walk around with them every day and go, my bestest? Critical about everything in life. Critical. Not thinking about the blessing. Amen. That you're not down at some waiting room somewhere in some hospital wondering if your loved one's going to make it, but you've got strength and health and you're walking around in the blessing of God. But yet, there's critical people even in the body of Christ.
Amen.
Jesus dealt with it. Lord, we can't spend that much money to feed this much. Are you nuts? It's not in our budget. And forget he made it all. But critical people are in the body of Christ. Power seekers. They'll step on you to get somewhere. And you begin to focus on them. I wonder what they're up to today. And you're not watching what God has for you in your life. Power seekers. Opinionated. created, we don't have anybody like that. Not in this precious body. Nobody's opinionated about anything. Perfectionist. They come into my office and look at my pictures and go, and everything has got to be just perfect. Life is never going to be perfect. And there's a lot of people distracted because of all unperfect people in the body of Christ. Well, honey, before you go to judging anybody else, why don't you get your compact out and look at yourself where you need to start with? There's nobody perfect in the body of Christ. We're all a bunch of mixed up, messed up, but thank God we're saved up and on our way to heaven. And he loves us in spite of ourselves. Amen. Amen. Attention seekers. So 50 are right around them and pat them on the back. And you cannot get your mind on God when you got a bunch of squall sacks around the church trying to get everybody's attention. Anybody with me? Still out there? Crank the truck. It's going to be bad. Amen. Intimidating people. Boy, I look like somebody that intimidates somebody else. Shouldn't be in the body of Christ, but the devil will use you to distract other people from the will of God. The list can go on. Is insecure, divisive. Somebody answer that. Jesus is calling. Amen. But they use distractions, Jack, to get us from the purpose and the will of God for our life. Let me go ahead and tell you something, every one of you here this morning, it's not about you. It's about Him and what He can do to all of humanity. So if you've got to have your ego fed and you've got to be the one, then honey, you're in the wrong place, because here it's all about Him first and foremost. Amen. Then he'll use distortion. He will never tell the whole truth. You know, when he tempted Christ, he only used portions of scripture. I've seen a lot of quoters over the years. I've been in ministry a long time. And I've heard them go to trying to quote the word of God, and they get bits and pieces, Herbert, but it's not the true meaning of scripture. And I have to, if the Bible actually says this, and quote it all the way down, Brother Gale, because there's a lot of people that want to distort God's word because it eases the conviction that's on their life. But let me tell you one thing, this book is not going to change for you or me or anyone else. Sin is still sin. I don't care how you try to address it. If it's against the word of God, then it's wrong. Amen? Amen. Amen. But now he uses distortion. Never tell the whole truth. Do you realize that all of us lose focus every now and then? And we got to be steered back. You teachers, God bless y'all's hearts. So, wherever you're sitting at this morning, I don't care how well you can teach. After a while, there's going to be some like this. There's going to be some like this. And you have worked and prepared that lesson. The reason I can tell you about sometimes you just can't keep focus. I don't know how I passed English in school. I didn't even attempt it in college. Amen. Because it always was after athletics. And I'll never forget, we were going at a lesson plan and getting all of this ready, and I am sound asleep on my desk. I got a drool puddle on my desk. I'm out. And she screams, and her name is Miss Martin. She taught Moses and Aaron and Miriam. And she hollers, "What are you laughing at, Lofton?" And I hear my name and I come back away. And I said, "Nothing." She said, "I ain't talking to you. You've been asleep since the mail rung." Every now and then we lose focus. Every now and then we lose our focus on what our purpose is in life. And the devil is laughing, leading you away. But it's time we get our eyes back on Jesus. And time we get our eyes back on the cross and say, "Hey, nothing is going to hinder me from making heaven." Amen. Nothing. Then he uses decoys. You know what a decoy is? Something artificial used to attract the real thing. It's a place that can be, that you can lure them to a place that can be trapped or shot. A thing or person used to lure someone into a trap. I miss Tim Kemp with all my heart. I love Tim. I don't see the point in duck hunting. If you duck hunters, that's y'all's gig. God bless y'all. I don't see setting out before daylight, sitting in water, freezing, to shoot a little old duck when a chicken you can buy at a store. That's not my thing. But he just begged Weston for me to come. Go duck up. Got the air boat, got the dog. He said, "Don't even bring a gun and shells." I went, "All right. It's going to be all right." We get to that air boat at 3:40. Yeah, that was the first sin right there. Amen. He said, "Put on these earmuffs, it's loud." And you get that feeling that something is not correct. I get them earmuffs and that hits me, and I stop and I look, and there's a spider about that big in that earmuff. I shot the boat full of holes and killed the dog with that spider. I'll tell you right now, I'm not into that thing. Anyway, I get it all cleared out, and he's laughing, and I get him wrapped, and we go all the way across that lake bed to the jungle. And we get there, and he said, "We got to throw out some decoys." He's throwing these little fake ducks everywhere. Now they're floating about daylight. He's there with that little call, and the dog sitting there, and I said, "Okay." And he said, "Here's your shells." I get my gun loaded, and I'm sitting there, and ducks come in after a while, and I go, he gives me a gun that won't shoot. I'm already up at 3:45. He got attacked by a spider, and then my gun won't shoot. What a wonderful time. So the next time he said, "You've got to come back, I'm sorry," but he never loaned me his gun to shoot one duck. So the next time he said, "Just come," I said, "I'll bring my own gun and my own shell." We get there, but now they got these decoys that every now and then they'll go. Daylight comes and I see a duck going. I come up out of that blind and Tim is screaming, "No, that's my decoy. If you're going to look like a duck, act like a duck, quack like a duck, you're going to get shot." And I'm going to tell you one thing. Let's talk about the decoys that's in the church. Just because you come in a suit and you look good and got your hair slicked back and got a Bible does not mean that you are part of the bride of Christ. You can talk one way inside the sanctuary but live totally different outside of that and do the things of the world, but yet you want the blessings of God. You're nothing more than a decoy, honey. Then you can't be a blessing or a benefit. Why? Because you are a fake. And God knows the difference between the real and the fake. And he's looking for a bunch of children that love him regardless of what life is. They're not a bunch of decoys. Amen? 2 points to that story. Be real. God knows it already. And 2, don't take me ducking. You see, decoys a lot of times fool the very best. Why, even the devil himself appears as an angel of light. Comes in. Oh, You've seen them. Glory to the Lamb. Oh, hallelujah. And you just get captivated. But you forget the main test. Does your spirit bear witness with their spirit? Do you feel that kindred spirit that goes and flows to the children of God? You better be careful who you follow and who you listen to. You better make sure that they are real and genuine and not a decoy sent by the devil. Amen? Then he uses destruction. Satan's master plot is just one thing for you, to destroy and put you to death. He hates you. Why? Because God created you after his image, and the devil is nothing more than a created angelic being. He hates you because it was God that turned to his son and said, let us make man in our image. And after created, he turned and said, it's good. He looks good. Then he created woman and he went, wow. Ladies, you're prettier than men. One portion of scripture in the Old Testament said that you are the jewel of God's creation because you're special. Husbands, you need to tell your wife how special they are every day, because they are something incredible that's been created by God.
Amen.
You're incredible. You're awesome. Lucky to have me. But God has a plan for you. Amen. He has a plan for me to get out of here alive. Amen. The key to understanding God's plan is found in the last phrase of that verse, 29:11. Plans to give you hope and a future. If your hope is in this world, you're going to be disappointed. Amen. But my hope is in the world to come. Amen. And a life in Jesus Christ. People can't find God's will in their life anymore. Why? Because they're always looking behind. I've got news for you. God's not behind you.
That's right.
God's in front of you.
Amen.
Leading and guiding you. Before you ever can find God's plan, you've got to leave two things behind. Number one, past failures that's going to block you from any movement with God. Just because you failed in your past does not mean that you're a failure today. Just because you tripped and messed up back then, you're not who you used to be. God can wipe that away and make you brand new. Amen? But we've got to be willing to let God erase it from us and others in the church. We've got to let God change them as well. Amen? How many of you have ever messed up in the past? How many has been forgiven? There it is. Forget those things that are behind you. Then you got to understand, not only is your past failures can be a hindrance, but your past successes. God may want to do something different this time. I was told by one of my best friends, he got married, little girl, was raised by her dad. Mom had passed early, and they got together and got married and went off on their honeymoon. This boy had saved and scrimped down there. He wanted to have a beautiful honeymoon. So he went to a fine steak restaurant. He said, honey, I'm going to take you here to show you what I'm going to do for you in life. He gets there and the waiter comes and said, they order steak. He said, how would you like that? And the girl said, well, gravy. And he said, no, honey, he wants to know how you want to cook it. She said, we always cook steak with gravy. I'd like to have mine with gravy, please. He said, I had to explain to her that they were going to grill that steak and how they wanted it cooked, if it wanted to be pink in the middle or like some of my grandchildren, jerk the horns off and cut your steak and eat it. Ooh. Well done. Now she goes to a restaurant and she says, I know not to say gravy. There's some things that you have to change in life. God doesn't want to do the same thing every time.
Amen.
He wants to take you from steak and gravy to something far greater.
Amen.
He wants to take you to a new heights. Just because we did one thing one way for so long, God has us in a different age and a different time that we got to do some things different in order to win the loss for Him. You see, you got to understand, this will never change. I don't care who you are, who you listen to. You cannot change the Word of God to draw men and women in. That will never change. But the fact of the matter, we are living in a society. I guarantee you, you could take your children to a phone booth and they wouldn't know what to do. What kind of time machine is that? And they would never call home because they would know not to put a quarter in. Something they're not used to. But you can give them any little apparatus out of your pocket. They can Google, they can search, they can Siri, they can do whatever they want to. And you said to go, what in the world are they doing? They are living in their generation and time. But I'm here to tell you, I don't want to just do the things the same way every time. I want a challenge. I want something different. Why? That causes the life of Christ to be more exciting. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So let God do some changes inside of you.
Amen. Glory.
God's will is always in front of you because God is in front of you.
Amen.
You got to ask yourself a question. Is God leading me and I'm following, or is He behind me pushing me every step of the way? It's a whole lot easier to follow than to be driven. And you see, we got a lot of people. God is trying to get you to get in His will, and you're constantly fighting. Listen, God is in front of you, so if He's in front of you, you are probably in His will because He is going to lead you down the path that you need to take. Listen to these promises in Exodus 34:24. I will cast out the nations before you and enlarge your borders. Deuteronomy 1:30, the Lord your God who goes before you, He will fight for you according to all He hath done for you in Egypt before your eyes. 1 Chronicles 14:15, and it shall be that when you hear the sound of marching in the tops of the mulberry trees, then you shall go out to battle. For God has gone out before you to strike the camp of the Philistine. It's a whole lot better to let God get in the lead. Why? He makes everything a whole lot smoother. Amen? And amen. The second thing you've got to realize is of great importance. God did not save you from something. He saved you for something.
Amen.
And you got to get it right up here. We can't seem to accept that we're in God's will because things always don't fall into place in our time. How many is a real anxious person? I want it right now. Got to have it right now. Those that wait upon the Lord, she ever knew this? It's where we mess up, we get ahead of God. But you got to wait on God's time. Listen to Deuteronomy 7:22. The children of Israel are having some difficulty. Why? God hadn't moved and done something now. And it says this, and the Lord your God will drive out those nations before you little by little. You'll be unable to destroy them at once, lest the beasts of the field become too numerous for you. God knows what He's doing, how He's doing it, and you just got to trust Him and have faith that everything is going to be all right. What you don't see, He does see. What you don't understand, He already knows the outcome. In Philippians 3:12-14, Sister Andrew, come. Not that I have already attained or already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Now listen to Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, I'm stopped right there to preach a week. How many's got loved ones that's already crossed over? You know who's sitting in the bleachers waiting on you? See, when they wrote this verse, it was like a marathon run that you run into a stadium. That was the end. Imagine yourself in this Christian race, Patty, running. And there's your precious mama sitting in the grandstands screaming your name. Screaming. Mama Jewel sitting right there hollering, Dale, you keep running. I know the devil has been beating on you, but keep running. You're almost there. And when you get there, Brother Jack, see all those that's gone before you standing and applauding as you come in. And Herbert, we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses that said, you can make it. I did. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And what about Philippians 1 and 6? Being confident of this very thing, Melissa, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it to the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. We used to sing a little song in kids' church, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. You got to understand, I don't care how old you are. I don't care what the devil has done and is fighting. God's not through with us yet. I found another scripture that really spoke to me this morning. I didn't give it to Carrie. But it's Ephesians 2 and 10 in the New Living Translation. It says, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Before you were even formed in the womb, Georgia, he knew everything about you, sweetheart. And the plans that he had planned for you. Every now and then we want to throw up our hands and go, boy, this is God's plan. Well, I wish you'd have got another one. But he knows exactly what you can endure and what you can take. But you were not just on some whim created. He fashioned you after his image. The devil has a plot to destroy you, but God has a plan to lead you home. And I don't know about you, but I want God's plan in my life. How about you? Would you bow your heads this morning, Savior? I come to you in the lovely name of Jesus, thankful for your word. Thank you for loving us even when we're messed up. Thank you for loving us as imperfect as we are. Before I was even born, you knew me. Created me. And it was not to do the plans that I had planned for myself. But you had a plan for my life. Today, Savior, I ask you to fight the enemy and push him back. Of all the distractions and distortions and the decoys and even the destruction he's trying to lead us into. Let us cry, Abba, Father. Let us find that plan that you have for our life. I ask you to become and lead me. Get ahead of me and I will follow. You won't have to push me anymore. But I'll listen for the direction you have for my life. And ask you to help me today. In Jesus' name. If you're here this morning and you're ready to see God's will and plan in your life, First, I just want you to stand right where you're at. If you're ready for God's will and plan in your life, just stand. Then the only person that can get you to that place is you and God. We will have to pray a prayer like Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane when he prayed this, "Not my will, but thine be done." John, it's not our will. Ronnie, it's not our will. Michaela, it's not our will. But his will be done in our life. So right where you're at today, I want you to pray with me that God will take charge of your life and show you the plan he has for you. Would you pray with me? Savior, I come to you in the lovely name of Jesus. I thank you first for saving me. And I ask you today to speak to me. Speak past all the distractions and all of the lure of the enemy. But I know your voice. And I want you to speak to my heart and my life. I seek your will in my life. Mine has made mess after mess. But I seek your will in my life. So today I ask you to help me and lead me and guide me to that purpose and plan you have for my life. I will no longer, God, try to figure it out on my own, but I'll wait for you to lead me. So today I surrender my life to you. What you want to accomplish, here I am. For I'm not my own. I've already been bought with a price. So lead me to your purpose. Lead me to your plan. God, I will follow. So direct my steps as your word says. Not that I get sidetracked or walk my own path, but God, that you will direct my steps. So today I surrender my heart, my life to you. And I ask it in faith in Jesus' name. And we all said,
amen.
Amen. The rest stand now, and I'll tell you what, I want you to hug somebody and tell them I love you and I'm praying for you. Wednesday, be here 7.